So for this point, it'd be really helpful if you had your Bibles. Have them open at Colossians chapters 3 and 4. And also don't forget your notebooks. I hope you're building up a notebook with lots of information about the things that you're seeing and discovering in Colossians. And we've got to the second half of chapter 3. So we're going to start at verse 18. And this week we're going to go through to chapter 4, verse 6. And I hope we're going to see actually how things get super practical. It was pretty practical last week. Gets super practical this week. But what we've seen so far in the message of Colossians, here's a very brief snapshot of the ground that we've covered. The first thing we've seen is as Paul writes to these new believers in the town of Colossae, these new Christians, the first thing he says is, I really want you to stick with Jesus. In him you have everything you need. Why would you move away from him or move on to anything else? He says, just as you've made a great start, you've received Jesus into your life as the way to be saved, the way to become a Christian. You've begun trusting fully in him. And so continue in the same way. Don't move away from the hope of the gospel. Don't move away from Jesus. So that's the first thing he says. The second thing he's kind of said is, be really wary and careful of people who are trying to say that being a Christian is about something else, something other than Jesus. And we saw some examples of how there are people trying to say, actually, it's about keeping rules and about following religious practices and that sort of thing. And Paul wants to say, don't be deceived by these ideas. Stick tightly and firmly to Christ. And as we've got into chapter 3 and into chapter 4, he's basically now saying, look, be sure to live it out. Put into practice what you've come to believe. Don't just be people who talk a good game or believe one thing, but actually live it out and put it into practice in your life. Last week, we saw how he spoke a lot about the things that they should put off as Christians, but also the things that they should put on. And we explored and looked at these different ideas together. And last week finished with verse 17. Let me just read to you that verse again. He said, whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. And it feels almost a bit of a catch-all. Whatever you do, whether word or deed, do it all in the name of Jesus. And this is the connective into today's passage. Remember, we've seen these connectives from one passage to another. The passage today, he's going to talk about some quite specific areas of our lives where he's saying, okay, whatever you do, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus. We're going to see this in terms of family relationships, in terms of workplace relationships, and in terms of actually how we relate to those who aren't Christians when it comes to our faith. We're going to touch on that a bit as well. So that's what's to come. But remember, he's saying whatever you do. So he's saying every area of your life. And then he's going to explore these specific areas. I guess as I was kind of thinking about this a little bit, I thought, these are the people we actually respect most in life, aren't we? Aren't they? When we meet people who live out and put into practice what they believe, and actually whatever their faith or religion or belief might be, we respect people who don't just say they believe something, but then don't really put it into practice in their life. We respect people who, whatever they believe, live it out and actually put it into practice in their life. And that's what Paul is encouraging these Colossians to do. I guess you could say people who aren't just, from a Christian point of view, people aren't just Sunday Christians, but live it out Monday to Saturday. There's this excellent book that I read not so long ago by Mark Green called Thank God It's Monday. And he really encourages us as believers to think, well, okay, I need to get really excited when it's Monday morning, because now I'm in the place where God has called me to be, whether that's a workplace or somewhere else. And actually, I'm going to have all sorts of opportunities to put my faith into practice, to live for Jesus in this situation, to obey God and serve him in the place that he's called me to. Whole life discipleship, putting it into practice as we go. I don't know if any of you read much about, and I can never pronounce his name right, but Sajid Javid's resignation this last week. He was actually saying a bit about the reason why he chose to resign. And the reason he gave was he went to something called the National Parliamentary Prayer Breakfast, which is an excellent initiative where clergy and MPs get together to pray for the government. And this one last week, the talker was a guy called Les Isaacs, who's the founder of Street Pastors. And Sajid Javid said the topic was all about integrity. And he said, as he listened to this talk, he's not a Christian himself, although he says his wife is. But he realized as he listened to this talk that he couldn't say, I believe integrity is a really important thing, and yet I'm serving in a government that doesn't believe that. And so he felt, well, I can't then continue in that government because what I believe in my life, I need to put into practice in how I'm living my life. I thought that was a really good example of how we're to put into practice the things that we believe. And Paul is encouraging the Colossian Christians to do that, particularly in the areas of family, of work, and how they live among those who don't share their faith. Paul wants them to know being a Christian is, as they're learning about what being a Christian is, he wants them to know it's not just about following the right or doing the right religious practices at the right times, but it's about living whole lives faithfully following Jesus. Now, I do need to say just a couple of things before we get into today's passage, because there's a couple of potential pitfalls, and I'm just going to mention those before we get into reading them. We're going to see there's sort of three pairs of commands: wives, husbands, children, parents, slave masters, and then there's a section at the end about sort of prayer and mission. But we're immediately, and this is the first thing I just want to say a bit about, we're immediately faced with something controversial in chapter 3, verse 18, where he says, wives, submit yourselves to your husbands as is fitting in the Lord. So we're faced with the S word, the submit word. And let me just say one or two things about that, because I think the problem is that as we hear this word, our minds naturally go to thinking about an overbearing and harsh husband who is forcing his wife to submit in a marriage that is not one of equals. And actually, this couldn't be further from the truth or from what's envisaged here in Paul's teaching. So let me just say five things that might help about this as we come to read it. First of all, the Bible is abundantly clear that men and women are 100% equal. There's no doubting that the Bible teaches that. The command to the husband, you'll see in the following verse, is to love his wife. And other bits of the Bible expand on that and say he's to love his wife as Christ loved the church. And the picture of Christ's love for the church is a sacrificial love and an unconditional love. And that's a really high calling for husbands, to love their wives. And so it's in that context and that setting that we read of the word submit. We're going to see as well that the husband is instructed not to be harsh with his wife. And the instruction to submit is actually directed to the wife, not to the husband. So there's no space whatsoever for thinking that this is in any way a forced submission on the part of the husband, but something that's entirely voluntary on the part of the wife. And it's the context of a marriage relationship. So again, there's no way for thinking this is something that applies for all women to all men. This is within a marriage, one wife and one husband. So I guess the context of a marriage where the husband loves his wife as Jesus loves us, what a high calling to love sacrificially and unconditionally. Well, in that context, I think, and I hope you'll see, the word submit has a completely different feel. However, unfortunately, those of us that are husbands will know that we frequently fail in this and fall a long way short. That's just to say something about that. Let me say something about the slaves and masters bit as well as just a second thing, because it's worth just clarifying that as we read about that, we shouldn't think of the context of the slavery of the 18th century, which saw such cruel mistreatment of many who are made in the image of God and should have been treated as equals and with value and dignity. Actually, the Bible would in no way defend that, and it was entirely right that was abolished. Actually, I think we're supposed to see the context here of slaves and masters as those who are working and employed in the home. And so I think as we read about that section in today's passage, the best way we can apply that to our context today is within workplace relationships, relationships between employees and employers. So I encourage you to think along those lines as we read this passage. So there we go. As you can see, there's a couple of pitfalls in these verses, but I really hope and I pray that they don't allow these pitfalls, we don't allow these to cloud the transformative teaching here about how living for Jesus can and should make all the difference in our lives and our relationships.
The Father's song, the Father's love, you sung it over me and for eternity. It's written on my heart. Heaven's perfect melody, the Creator's symphony, you are singing over me. The Father's song, heaven's perfect mystery, the King of love has sent for me, and now you're singing over me, the Father's song. I have heard so many songs, listen to a thousand tongues, but there is one that sounds above them all. Thank you, Lord. The Father's song, the Father's love, you sung it over me and for eternity. It's written on my heart. Heaven's perfect melody, the Creator's symphony, you are singing over me, the Father's song. Heaven's perfect mystery, the King of love has sent for me, and now you're singing over me, the Father's song.
One of the questions to think about was, what stands out for you in the various instructions? The one that stood out for me was, fathers or parents, do not embitter your children, or do not antagonize your children, or they will become discouraged. I wonder what it was that stood out for you as you read through that chapter. Well, we'll have a chance to talk that through in a minute, but let me just say a final word before we go into breakout rooms about the section at the bottom, chapter 4 verses 2 to 6 that we had a look at, because Paul here seems to start to address mission. He asks the Colossians to be praying for him, and he says they should be praying for themselves. He says they need to be wise in the way that they act towards outsiders, wise in their words and their actions, and also bold as they seek to share the gospel with others. And just as I was reading this, I wondered if perhaps here we see quite a specific example of how we can grow to maturity as Christians, if that's what Colossians is all about. And I think when we begin to start to seek to share our faith with others, then that's a real step towards us growing towards maturity as Christians. In my experience, when you are doing this, when you're actively, intentionally, and prayerfully, as you live out your life in the places which God has put you, as you're actively, intentionally, and prayerfully seeking to share your faith with others, well, this leads to real growth in our maturity as Christians.